Yes, thank you very much. I'm really very pleased and honored to be here with you. And because Madame la Présidente was kind enough to introduce me with my present assignment, I want to stress it very clearly that I'm not speaking from the position of the Director of the Foreign Intelligence Service. I'm speaking here as a professor. Simply, please do not try to identify what I'm saying here with the interest of our service, who are very, very specific. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me, first of all. It's always a pleasure to be in a room in which the majority are lawyers, and it's a privilege to be in a room in which the majority of lawyers are specialized in international law. It's true, it's not a very fashionable field sometimes. You can get much more money in private law, in other fields. But I, from my point of view, I consider it one of the best fields of the law, offering a lot of satisfactions, not always of a material nature. Now, having said that, may I express some special thanks to Madame Motok for organizing this important event in cooperation with the European Society for International Law. Okay, now in 10 minutes you do not expect me to make a very serious presentation. I will try simply to say a few ideas or words about the relationship between internal and international law, and please do take them as a kind of incentive for your discussions. Now, I will start by confirming, if there is any need, what Madame la Présidente said. The topic of relationship between international law and internal law is as old as the international law itself. There were always, from a scientific point of view, two basic approaches. The dualist approach, Oppenheim and Ancelotti represented with distinction this this approach. They consider that internal and international law are different. Subjects are different. Of course, in internal law, you have citizens, individuals. In international law, you have states. International law is very different because in internal law, you have a unique expression of the will of the parliament, or whoever is making the laws in that country of one state, while in international law practically you have the expression of a common view or the lowest common denominator of the view of the states. And of course the main argument they were using is the absence in international law of any superior authority over the subjects of international law, the states, to ensure the full respect of the provisions and also the application of sanctions. These are very solid arguments, but the monist approach is also benefiting of a lot of important arguments. The legal world is unitary. There are no differences in nature, they say, between the two branches. There are only differences of degree. International law and internal law have a common structure, and their opinion is that in the future the international law will follow more or less the internal law, even from the point of view of structures. Now, it's true that this difference, this approach, these two different schools are mainly useful from a scientific or let's say didactical point of view. In reality, in the majority of the countries, this distinction is not very clear. And Madame Motok was very inspired in quoting here two articles from the Romanian constitution. Is the constitution of our country. Article 11 speaks very clearly about the process of ratification of the treaties and incorporation of the provisions of the treaties in the internal law, while Article 20, when he's speaking about, of course, human rights, is clearly specifying that in case of a dispute between the internal provisions and the international provisions will prevail. It's simply to say do not attach too much attention to the preoccupation of being in one school or the other. Let's try to concentrate from a practical point of view on how the things are working. Now, in our days, one of the fashionable subjects in the international debates, it's the subject of the fragmentation, quote unquote, of the international law. There are a lot of new fields, specialized fields appearing, like humanitarian international law, law of the sea, law of the airspace, and so on and so forth. This subject was in the preoccupation of the International Law Commission, and we had a discussion on a report about the fragmentation of the international law. The conclusion is very simple, that these specific laws which appeared in the last period of time are simply trying to adapt general principles of international law to a specific field of activity and finding the best solutions in the framework of the general principles of international law. But everybody recognized that in some of the fields we have provisions which are different from the general provisions of the international law, or sometimes even contrary to some provisions of the international law. And the proposal, the conclusion we arrived at was that if we follow the principle specialis generalibus derogant, it means that for these specific fields of law, what is it specific will prevail over the general principles of international law. Of course, it's a very interesting subject, it's very fashionable, but from my point of view, it's a subject less important than the subject of the possible fragmentation of the international law, in the sense of the different interpretations of the general principles and some of the general provisions of the international law. What happened practically? We are living in a world in which the main, the basis of the international law was created after the Second World War, and at the same time we have a lot of evolutions in the practical life of the international society. And if we are not making an effort to approach from a scientific point of view, but also from a realist point of view, the realities which are happening in the world, we can run into the risk of having two different readings of the same provisions of the international, public international law. Today, there are some basic issues in which you can already notice this dual approach. And from my point of view, any effort in this field should start with the redefinition of certain principles of or norms of the international law. Now, these main principles are written in the United Nations Declaration on Friendly Relations and Cooperation Between States. This was adopted in 1970, and the basic principles contained in this document are the principles of sovereignty, national independence, non-interference in internal affairs, and the right to self-determination. This situation made that in some cases, like it was the case of the intervention in Yugoslavia or in other parts of the world, we were confronted with a lot of discussions about the legal basis for these interventions. The fact that another declaration was adopted in 81, a declaration on the I'm translating from Romanian. If it's wrong, don't take it seriously. On the inadmissibility of the interference in internal affairs of the states, which are clearly saying, I'm quoting, my translation is mine, no state or group of states has the right to interfere or to intervene in any mode, in any way, and for any reasons in the internal affairs or external affairs of other states. These kind of provisions are clearly proving that we have a set of principles, and the only problem is how do we read these principles. And one of the best issues for this is exactly the reference to the principle of non-interference in internal affairs. Slowly but gradually, other ideas appeared, and one of these ideas, le droit d'ingérence pour des raisons humanitaires, le devoir d'ingérence, the obligation to intervene for humanitarian reasons, something of this kind. It's obvious that as long as we'll continue to read UN Charter, the very important documents, in a conservative way, or in a very, let's say, quote-unquote, progressive way, both don't take it seriously. I mean, it's conservative and progressive in order to make a difference. We run, I repeat, into the risk of having two different readings of the same provisions of the international law. Now, there is hope. Don't believe that this nothing has happened in this field. We have a declaration of the millennium, which was adopted by the United Nations in 2000 with the participation of heads of states and so on and so forth and government. And it's for the first time when in a UN document we have a different structure of the references to the international law. It starts with a presentation of the values and fundamental principles which are laid at the basis of the international relations, like freedom, equality, solidarity, tolerance, respect for nature, and solidarity responsibility. And these kind of things appear also in other documents. What I simply wanted to say in concluding is that we are in a very important moment in which our preoccupation as practitioners, as specialists in international law, is to try to take stock of what was happening in international relations in the last period of time, what should be done, and arrive together with other states at a common reading of the provisions of international law. Otherwise, we'll have two different international laws, two readings of the same one international, public international law. Thank you very much.